All right, my name is Shannon Campo. I am one of the choreographers, dance leaders, team dance leaders, photographer, artist, whatever, here at the feast. I came with my husband, Timothy, and his parents, and my brother, sister-in-law, and my nieces and my nephews, and two of my nieces are right there. So this is really exciting to be here. We're going to open with prayer first. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for this time when we have to come and celebrate a feast, to worship you, to be thankful, to be able to learn new things, and to do them for your glory and for your honor. And Heavenly Father, please help the words that I speak, the things that I do, the things that I say, the motions that I make to be clear and understandable, that they will bring glory to you and be good for teaching and for showing others how to bring you glory. I just thank you for this opportunity to share this passion that you have given me to worship you, to glorify you with lives and prayers, and share that with other people who wish to do that for you as well. Yeshua's name, amen. Welcome. I just love that you're here. And it's totally cool if there's not so many of you, because we really have fun with flag. This is a flag worship session. I'm going to keep looking up there, so. My lovely, wonderful, awesome husband is back there, and he is going to be flipping them whenever I do this, so I'm not crazy, I'm going to change the slide. We're going to talk a little bit about flags, what they are, banners, their use in scriptures, and then how to make them, take care of them, and then also how to present yourself when you are using flags and banners. My first slide is a flag. What is a flag? A flag is something that is used to signal. Yay! A piece of cloth, varying size, shape, color, design. Everyone's seen the little flags on ships that are all different colors. They did that before they had radio, so they would tell other ships a message, sort of like Morse code is a message that you can hear. Well, a flag would be a message that you could see, and they could tell other ships information. In war, they always have the flag that goes out in front of their group, and it was always never let the flag fall down. And the Roman army, which was one of the greatest armies in the entire world, they conquered much of the world. Every group would go out and meet the standard. And these 1,000 men would all be under this standard, and then they would organize themselves by hundreds and thousands and tens of thousands, and they would follow their standard. That would be them. And sign, standard, everything like that is different words for it. Sorry, I waved my hand and he thought I was saying. Go ahead, the next one. The Bible refers to the flag as a standard or a banner. A standard would be something that would go out in front of a military group, and a banner would just be something that would be waved over their head. The Hebrew word dagal is translated as flag or banner or standard. And dagal comes from the Hebrew root word dagal. Bottle change there goes from D to A. And some of you have taken Hebrew, you know there's always three main letters that are the roots of every undergrad, Scott, all those kind of who teach the main root of the word. So dagal is that root. And it means to flaunt, to raise up, to be conspicuous. If I have a banner and I'm standing up here doing this, you're going to notice me, right? So I'm being conspicuous. And that is what you want to do with a flag. If you're sending out a message of some sort, it could be a good message, a bad message, you're doing something and a message is being sent. A banner is defined as a flag or a cloth standard. Banner, flag, pennant, they're all kind of used interchangeably in the English language. Sometimes if you're in like color corps, or in military, you might call a specific thing a name, and it's that's its name, but this is a different name. But in general usage, you can sort of change them all up. The standard is more of a military or a personal flag type thing. It organized the Hebrews. In the Old Testament, Yahweh commands Moses to instruct the children of Israel to camp by their own standard. by their tribe. Okay, we're thinking there's something like, what, 3 million people that came out of Egypt? Even if it was only 400, that's still a lot of people to keep organized. And everybody was by their tribe, and remember the tribes all were in order, and this tribe had to get up and go, and the next tribe, well, how did you know what tribe was, you know, what tribe are we on? Which one are we next? They all had flags, they all had standards. And I think it would have been amazing to see what their flags look like, because we have banners for each one of the tribes. I would love to know what their banners look like, what their pictures were, what their colors were. 12 different flags and banners, Numbers 152, and the sons of Israel shall camp each man by his own camp, each man by his own standard according to their armies. So they may have had, tribe of Levi had this banner. Well, you know, there were different sons of Levi, and some of the Levites did this thing for the temple, and some people carried this thing, and some people were in charge of the poles, and some people were in charge of the lanyard, and then they each had their own flag too. And so the families, their own standards, could have their own flags. So if a little kid's wandering around like, man, he's getting home, all he has to do is look for his family's flag, and he can get himself home by looking for that flag. That way we see. And Moses built an altar and named it, "The Lord is my banner." Nisi means banner. His banner over me is love. This is Song of Solomon. "You are as beautiful as Sisera, my darling, as lovely as Jerusalem, as awesome as an army with banners." How many of you like going to like the Memorial Day parade and the 4th of July parade and all that? And you see all those people walking with all the flags, and whenever you see the band coming from like the school, what's the best part? Flags, the first part where they're all waving their flags and all going. That's what he's comparing his bride to. Something that's just beautiful and magnificent, coming in, and everyone's excited to see her and think she's beautiful. That's what he's telling his bride. Psalm 25, "We will sing for joy over your victory, and in the name of our God we will set up our banners. May the Lord fulfill all your petitions." So this is like a banner as you're sending up a prayer. You're making a picture to Yahweh and saying, this is our petitions, this is our praise and our glory that we are giving to you by raising this piece of fabric and showing you, making a motion, doing something. Just today, Joe Good in his message was saying that the banner represented Messiah. And I was like, oh, I didn't do that. And it's just so cool that Messiah is this huge thing in Scripture, all throughout Scripture. Every time that banner was raised, that means that when Messiah is being raised, and he was raised from the dead to be our sacrifice for our sins. And if he was not raised, there would be no forgiveness of sins. So every time you raise that, you think, you were raised from the dead for me. You forgave my sins through your death. That's just an amazing picture. Psalm 64, "Thou hast given a banner to those who fear thee, that it may be displayed because of the truth." Everybody who has an American flag in their front yard, everybody knows that you're patriotic, right? We have that same kind of idea. We have a big flag that says, "I am Yahweh's," in front of our yard or in our life. Isaiah 11:10, "And it will come about in that day that the nations will resort to the root of Jesse, who will stand as a signal banner for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious." Who are the people of Jesse? This was in Joe Good's message. David. David came out of Jesse. And out of that, Judah, the Jewish people right now are a standard for the Torah. And so that's a pretty big thing that they are a standard for. Everybody, when they look at the Jewish people, they think of the Torah and how they keep the law and the covenant. Isaiah 62:10, "Go through the gates, clear the way for the people, build up the highway, remove the stones, lift up a standard, a flag for the peoples." Flags communicate messages through symbols. We're going to go through all of these in a minute. Color, shape, size, motion, and music. Usually when we do flags up front, there's music going on. When the flags are going down the street with the band, there's music going on. So to me, they're kind of receiving the white flag, just one. and victory. Black, darkness, evil, sin, famine, humility. Red is the blood of Yeshua, cleansing, justification, atonement, war, and war, there is much blood spilled. Death, love, what's the color of a heart is always red. Life, redemption, sacrifice. You have both life and death in that color. So it depends on how you use that color, which idea you get across. Amber, or like a gold or a yellow, is a glory of Yahweh, fire of passion, flame of Yahweh, the temple of Yahweh, wisdom. Green, eternal life. When you think of green, you think growing plants or mold. Vigor, prosperity, mercy, restoration, healing, a new beginning. It's springtime. Blue is always Yahweh. In the scriptures, it's Yahweh. Blue is Yahweh's color in the tabernacle. Blue is the color of tzitzit to remind your fellow people. See, wearing that we have a covenant with Yahweh. And we do this because we want to honor Him and because we love Him. Grace, kingship, can't remember the rest, priesthood, authority, and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is often pictured as wind or pouring out of water, which is blue, and heaven. Purple is royalty, and purple is royalty because to make the color purple, you had to go collect about a million little snails, pull out their innards, use a little small sack that they had, crush that all up, and then you can. How many snails do you think you had to go murder to make under something purple? So it was a rather costly endeavor to create this color purple. So that's why usually only the royalty had it. Or in scripture, when they talk about the woman who was the seller of purple, she was a very wealthy woman. And she was a Christian in the early church. And she helped her fellow saints. But it's just very interesting that he mentioned that she was a seller of purple, because it's a very, if you're a merchant of that, you had to have some kickback from that. Kingship, majesty, mediator. Who is our mediator? Yeshua is our mediator with the Heavenly Father. Wealth and penitence. Silver, the word of Yahweh, which is a two-edged sword, sharper, those swords are silver. Redemption, divinity, righteousness, and gold, eternal deity, Yahweh, glory, purification, majesty, righteousness, divine light, kingliness, trial by fire, what gets burned to be made pure? Gold dust. And it has to be burned for a while to get all the cut off. So we are being tried by fire. The purpose is to make us pure. So yeah, it sucks when I go through it. But the end is what you need to look forward to, just like labor means looking forward to what you get at the end of all this trial. And for those of us who've never had children, I'm going by what I've been told. Shapes. There is the familiar rectangle. That's probably what most flag shapes are. Just a plain old rectangle or a square. Flags can be any shape want. So, this is a three-layer flag that came out of the fact that I did not have enough fabric to make two flags that were the same and have them all be pink. So, I took and made layers out of it. So there are three layers on this flag. I made ones that were blue for my husband so I didn't have to carry the banner on them. Yes. I didn't. I think new words would be a very good thing for me. I didn't find out what pink meant. Probably something along the lines of the red is representing, maybe. Maybe red and white combined some of those ideas put together. So those are a couple of different shapes. Here's another shape that we have. So it's. That's another kind of shape. Banners and streamers can often be very long and flowing, so there's one idea. Everyone has seen the ribbons, especially in the Olympics. You see the girls just do incredible things with the ribbons. That's another type of flag, actually. Any size flag can be used. However, there are some considerations that may limit your size. Like having an 8-foot ceiling would definitely limit the size of the flag you'd want to use. And here, this is awesome. I don't think I could hit the ceiling if I wanted to. The room is very key. If you are going to do a flag presentation at your fellowship or at a place where you are at, take into consideration the room you actually have. Because a big flag would be absolutely beautiful, but if you have a 12-foot ceiling, a 10-foot pole on top of a 5-foot, 5.5-foot person, you've already exceeded the height of your ceiling if you have any but small unit that. So definitely take into consideration the size of your room, what size you can physically handle. I'm a beach volleyball player, thus I do a lot of upper body, physical upper body. So for me, this is not hard. But for someone else who may not have used the muscles in their arms as much as I have, 2 minutes of this and you're crying already because you're like, my arm hurts. So what you can physically move is important too, because if you're doing a 5-minute song, you want to make it through all 5 minutes and still have the motions that you meant to and not be going, you know, like that. So you can work up to bigger flags. Very much so. You can lift some weights, you can do something. There is some physical fitness that does go with any movement, of course. So make sure that you can handle the flag that you're getting and practice. And expense. If you make your flags, I am a frugalish person, and I make it myself because I do not want to pay $80 for a flag online. I will buy what I need to if I cannot make it myself. But I make most of my flags, and I just look, God has given me a wonderful ability to look at something and be able to replicate it. It's a huge gift, and I completely know it's a gift. So, like this, I made up out of my head. But I go, this is LeMay, this is type of fabric. I will go and buy stuff on clearance and have a crafter, which is the biggest room in our house. My husband loves me very much. It's got a lot of fabric in it, so I will buy an entire bolt of fabric if I think it's pretty. And it's a good flag material because it takes a lot of fabric to make a big flag. So that is another thing. So if you're making flags for little kids, a 12 by 12 flag on a little dowel cut in half is plenty big for them. If you have to make 15 of them, you know, people look for every kid in fellowship, that's fine. And that's okay. Your flag doesn't have to be the biggest thing in the room. So another thing is how many people are going to be using flags in space. The space might be big enough for you and your flag, but if there's more than one person, you want to keep that in mind too, so you're not taking people's heads off while you're spinning your flag around. Motion. How you move conveys a message. Okay, how many of you guys know this one? What am I telling you? I'm mad. Anyone want to listen to you? No, not really. Not if I'm standing like this. I'm happier. My body is open. I am receiving of anything that's coming at me. Same thing goes with dance. Same thing goes with any motion. So if you're walking around like this, what is that telling you? I may not feel so great about myself. I'm sad. I do not have the joy of having my father in my heart right now. My shoulders are back. I'm up. I'm square. I'm looking at what I'm doing, and I look like I have some self-confidence. That sends a completely different picture. So when you do something in front of people, you have to be very cognizant of how you're presenting yourself to them. Because you can completely destroy a message. Does that have anything to do with how the wind blows or how water flows? No, so you want to be cognizant of what the words are saying, and that's what you're doing to the words. Message of the song again. Shouts of joy. You can go to town on shouts of joy. It's shouts of joy, and you're bouncing, and it's fun, and it's fast, and that's a great song to go and just move. But then Amazing Grace is totally different. And you can even see just in the dance rooms that we have up front, the tone that the dance leaders have set for each song. We're doing something really pretty and graceful. For school stuff, at Shouts of Joy, we're just hauling, we're just going to town on it. So that's something very key, the unity thing, again, and your message to get to your audience. I'm a choreographer. I choreograph probably 90% of the stuff I do for my fellowship, for theater, things like that. So you have to, I'll listen to the song over and over and over, write down all the words, figure out all the timing and all the beats to it before I even start moving. And sometimes Yahweh is gracious and wonderful, and he will just download a dance in my head, and it's awesome. Sometimes I have to work it out beat by beat and go, no, this is not going to work, and keep working on it. So it just depends. And if you don't think you can choreograph something, if you can walk from here to there and not fall on your head, you have just choreographed movement. It doesn't have to be difficult. It does not have to be hard. To listen to the music and let Yahweh move you. Because if we are all have Yeshua in our hearts, if we've all committed ourselves to Him, He lives in us. And He wants to be with us and speak to us. And if we have a desire to glorify Him in movement, He will show us if we let Him how to move. And again, practice. Nobody is a double A volleyball player the first week they walk out on a beach stand. No, they need to run about 5 million suicides, serve the ball 500 times. It's something, you have to practice. That's just part of life. No one is really good at anything the first time ever unless God just dumps a bunch of stuff in their head. So practice is very key to this as well. I've never talked about this topic yet. All right. Hair flags, how to make flags, costumes, modesty, attitudes, favor. Flags are a prop. It is a tool. They in themselves are not holy. They in themselves are not to be set above something else. It is simply a prop. Just like a microphone is a prop, just like the decorations up there are a prop. But they're used to bring people into the presence of Yahweh. And also because we are stewards, we need to take care of what we've been given. Whether it's my flag, your flag, it shouldn't matter. You should treat anything, the chair you're sitting on, with care, because we are to be good stewards of what Yahweh has given to us. And so that is something very important that I found. Because I'm a little bit stronger, I will be a little bit more aggressive with my flags. And somebody graciously said, oh, you can use my flags. And I was someplace and I didn't have mine with me. And I picked it up and I did this with the flag and knew immediately that if I kept going, I would hurt her flags. Just because the way I do that motion, I would pull the seams out of her flags because I weighed them. She just did this with her flags. That's all she ever did with them. And her flags were fine for what she did. But my movement that I do in just this thing, if my flag doesn't have a double seam in it with a casing, it's toast. So I told her, I said, your flags are beautiful, but I will hurt your flags. So I'm not going to use them right now. And that was because I didn't want to cause her pain by hurting something. And I didn't want to show off by saying, well, I'm a flagger. I can do this anyway. And if it rips, then that's her fault. That is not being a good steward of her things. That is not having a good attitude for me. And that is not giving him glory because my attitude is completely wrong. So stewardship goes just beyond not dumping a flag on the floor and things. You want to roll them, you want to put them away nicely. You don't want to hit anybody with them. Because if you hit someone with a flag the first time, I'm like, okay, you unless, you know, circumstances are extended, you know, but if you are playing sword fights with a flag, yeah, you not got the right idea for what we're doing. And then respect. In dance, as well as in flags, you have a circle that's supposed to be your personal space. Well, when you have a flag, your personal space just went from a 3-foot circle to 15-foot diameter circle. This is my space now. If anyone is in my space, I'm going to hit them. So you have to show respect for the people that are around you. You have to show respect for the person who has a flag who's by you. If you just happen to be standing there and someone's playing with a flag, don't just walk like that. I've had people literally walk like within a foot of me. And I'm doing a flag and I'm worshiping and I've, you know, I made sure that I'm okay with my spacing. I'm not going to hurt anybody. I'm not blocking an aisle way. But they decided that they need to be over there and they walk. I mean, came this close to hitting a lady in the head and I opened my eyes just in time to see. And I went, yay! So respect goes both ways. Whether you have a flag or somebody else has a flag. And if someone's truly worshiping, sometimes they won't see you. If they've already checked out their space and made sure they were good, they've gone and entered in, and you're distracting them. So respect goes both ways on that one. But two, your flag is a lot bigger than what you think often. So sometimes I tell people, just do a circle. If you don't hit anything, this is good. Fabric types. Okay, we'll talk about some fabric here. Got this one. And this one. Got that one.
But it'll last outside a long time and it'll hold up to your element.
front and the back. The front will be real bright, whatever color it is, and the back will be real dull and ugly. So Lene is the same on both sides, so it makes a great flag. And that's also another thing you want to take into account is flags have two sides. So if you have an awesome material, but it's only one-sided, you'll have to either put another fabric on the back, or double it up, or do something, spray paint it, things like that to make both sides pretty. Unless it's going to be a banner and you're simply going to be holding it in one way, or it's going to be on a wall or something like that. So Lene is really great. Tribeca is another brand name of a type of fabric that's like posh, or like silk accents. Polyester lining, Eric's talked about. And then anything that flows. I'm weird. I go to the fabric store and I walk along and I'm like, I still have and I'll take out a bolt, I'll put out a bunch and I'll start doing this with the bolts and people just think I'm insane. But the fabric store people like me because I come there a lot with my coupons and I buy a lot. But this stuff I have found to be wonderful flag material. Any of the shears, anything sparkly, anything, let's see, there's another one. This is just a sheer, because it's so light, it will flow. And it doesn't have the really great ripples that the posh does, but because it's so light, it will still flow. And it's sparkly, and it looks good on both sides. So that makes a fun flag too. I think I've gone through all the flags again. Okay, next. How to make a bag. Great. This is where if you guys have questions and I say something too quickly and you miss it, stop me because it's easier to ask now than it is at the end when I don't necessarily have in my head what you're asking. Okay, this is just a square or rectangle flag. I am also a firm believer in trying to make it easy. So, a selfie, does everybody know what a selfie is? Okay, anybody who sews would know what that means, but the selvedge is the edge of the fabric where they bind it off. So it's not going to fray, it's not going to come apart. And then usually, when you have by a bolt of fabric, the fabric is folded in half kind of thing, and your selvedges will be on the ends, and then your top and your bottom, in this case of this flag, is going to be the part where they cut it, which will fray. So my ends, I roll the seam. I have a little seam roller foot on my sewing machine. So I feed it in there and you gotta get it all wiggled in there, but it will make a roll. So this is folded in half and then folded again. And that makes a really good seam that will stay. I knot all the ends of my threads. Just double, triple knot them. Sometimes if I know a flag is gonna go through a lot of pain, I may put some glue on the ends of the seams just so they stay. Because it's much easier to put a data glue on it and let it dry than it is to go back and fix your flag. The top part, this is the sleeve, all the sleeve, because that's what you put your pull through. I will fold my fabric in half and figure out how big the sleeve needs to be. And then I will fold this again. So there's actually three layers of fabric right here that I put my two seams through. The first seam is the one that holds the pull in. The second seam is my backup. That keeps this little flap that I've got here folded down. It's my backup in case this seam bursts. It also just provides a little more stability along this pull. So some people, depending on how thick your sleeve is, this one is a good example. This one, because it's three fabrics, my sleeve on the inside has another piece of thicker, heavy, it's a heavy cotton that I have inside of this sleeve, and I sewed this one three times. So my sleeve is this one, and if these two seams actually hold my flag material on to this. So this is like a piece of fabric that's folded like this over top of these three pieces, and that's going to hold it all together. I think I put a seam down with three pieces. also just stays nice. Okay, next, I think I went way ahead of me. There is anti-fray product. There's a solvent that's an anti-fray. You put that along your seam if you're not a sewer. That seals the seam, and then you don't have to necessarily do that rolled hem that I do on all of mine if you don't have a sewing machine or you don't have a foot or whatever. This is a sleeve and a channel. I use wood dowels. You get the 36-inch wooden dowel. We'll make this flag size. And you can just make it, you know, you can make a flag like this off of it or a longer flag or whatever. This is a 36-inch dowel. This is very appropriate for kids. Anyone who has shoulder problems or elbow problems or carpal tunnel or anything like that, this makes a relatively light, easy flag to do. It's also very travel with it. This flag is really cool. Let's check this out. I can take it off, wash it, or pack it, or whatever I need to do. And this one that I saw at a conference, could not find out where I could buy one big pattern. And I went online, my mother found the picture for me, and I made it. I was looking at a picture, girl, thank God, because that was interesting. Because that was completely enclosed in fabric, I don't need any tape to hold it on. It stays because the channel keeps it there. These flags are taped. Clear duct tape is an awesome, harmless, wonderful thing. This one has a cap on it, and this is actually sliding down a little bit. And then we taped it with clear duct tape at the top and the bottom. If you don't do that, your flag will move around your pole and it'll end up all twisted. So your top might be like 3 revolutions further around than your bottom, which will make you keeping your flag straight extraordinarily hard. And also, if you really get going, your flag's going to come off the end of the pole. And so you're going to lose your flag. So that is a really simple, easy way to do it. You can take it off and wash your flag if you want. But that's just a really simple, easy way. There are a couple other ways of keeping your flag on. I said that. This one is Velcro. That is one way. You put like a big staple into your wooden pole or whatever, and then you would run a little tab that goes through it with Velcro on it. That's one way to do it. This is actually a practice pole for color guard that I got to press out. It's like, yay! And this has Velcro on the inside of the flag, so you can put that Velcro on before you put your seam in. And then they use the sticky Velcro tabs to put it on the pole. So then all you have to do is switch it out and then you just stick it back down. And that works really well. Especially for practice poles or things where you're going to be changing your flag a lot and you only have one pole. This pole is expensive. If you were to buy one of these online, they run $35 or $40 sometimes. It's a metal pole with stoppers on the end. You can make them if you want, but they have a weight. They're weighted a little bit, so they're, you know, even, and then when you flip them around, you're not losing them, and I haven't practiced them like in a while. But you can flip them and that kind of thing. And so that makes it good if you have a really good pole and you want to switch out your flags, you don't want to duct tape them at that point. This is a good way of doing it with the Velcro. And it's actually serged. Each of the fabrics is serged together, then they do a straight hem in it. So that's, you know, you can get more complicated with your colors. My favorite flags, I made this thing, these are my favorite flags, is this. These are fun, they're small, you can go for a long time on them. I usually dance with 2 flags just because I use both arms when I dance. And to me, it's natural to have 2 flags. So when you do your terpizia and you do your mayo, it flows. And it's fun. flight, you go forever with them. When they're gone, they travel. Costume and dress. Unity. Unity is very important. In Scripture, it talks about unity a lot. Most of the commandments in Scripture are about being in unity with the people around you, with Yahweh, with community, things like that. The Ten Commandments are all about being nice to your neighbor so you're not fighting all the time. So unity is very important, especially if you're going to be with a group of people doing flags or a group of dancers and flags. You have to be together. Because if you're not, and there's chaos, you will not be crossing over, like Lee said, because you're going to be distracting somebody else. It's going to look wrong. It's going to look funny. It's going to be obvious something wrong is going on. So it's not, it's just, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. So color. Usually when I do things like this for the presentation dance, and I had everybody coming down the aisles with the flags, only about half of those people actually knew they were doing that before they got here. I was right, I'm like, hi, guess what? So dark pants and a light colored shirt was all I asked for. And then we put the little garments on and everybody came down the aisle and it looked unified. Even though one kid knew about 10 minutes before he was going to do it that he was doing it. He just happened to have the right clothes on, so I'm like, hi, guess what you're doing? So color makes a big difference. And also your message that you're trying to get across makes a big difference on what colors you want to use. Season of Our Joy has the white skirts and the white blouses. And then I just make a new garment costume every year that we put on over it. So we're all in unity in color and things like that. And white also is, you know, celebratory and exciting and things like that. Myself, I made, I think, 10 or 11 black dance skirts, the full, like the white ones, but they're just full black ones for all my girls who dance in my home. So my dance classes at home, I have a skirt for everybody, and so we all have black skirt bottoms, and then we all just wear like either a similar colored shirt, or we'll wear like a rainbow shirt, you know, everybody's got a color of rainbow kind of thing. So there's all some sort of a unity in there. I also think black because if you sit on the floor and you stand up, you can't tell that you just did that. White is terrible. It's hard to do dress, pants or skirts. Season of Our Joy prefers us to be wearing skirts. I think one, because we're women and it looks pretty. If you're a guy, I'm not talking to you right now. Some people think that, you know, sometimes it's a personal preference that you wear a skirt when you're dancing or when you're giving presentation. I personally don't really care, but pants show off your figure a little bit more. So your backside, your legs, sometimes like that, and you know, if someone's wearing tight pants, it doesn't matter what shape they are, it's noticeable. And so sometimes skirts cover a multitude of sins, which is a good thing. And also, it's easier to be in unity a little bit more if everybody has a skirt on, just because those are easier to match, I think. There are some really neat dance pants that you can get. I own many pairs. I wear them under my skirts. I wear them in my dance classes. Sometimes with like a little short mini skirt. The only time I can wear mini skirts is over my dance pants. It's cute. It works. And it's modest. So I don't care. If you're wearing pants and you want to come dance up here in the front during worship, please come. You know, we're not saying you can't, but if you're doing a presentation, you might want to think about who you're doing it for. You know, your congregation will definitely, you're doing it for, will definitely should think about what they're going to think about a dress. So someone is looking at what you're wearing, they're so focused or upset on what you're wearing, they're going to completely miss what it is you're doing up here. And that is not the goal. And often, what you think is modest sitting out there in a chair, and what is fine, when you get up here, you need to triple it. Because sitting down in a chair is very different than making a turn up here and bending over or moving. And so it is our responsibility as children of God. Yahweh to protect our brothers, our friends, family, the people who are watching us. And it's just a sign of love. And we do our best to be modest and to be holy before Yahweh. And Yahweh, we dress and the way we move. And if someone has an issue with that, we can go in with it because I didn't make up that rule. But sometimes pants are okay. Like, I've seen some really, really cute where they have the real wide black dance pants, and you can really see their feet that way, and then they have these long tunics that come down about right here, and it looks really, really, really cute. It's beautiful, it's modest, it's great. But if you have a pair of jeans on, and you're dancing, and like, if you bend over, because the jeans are a little lower, you know, hit my point. Skirts, I make my dance skirts from the McCall's pool skirt costume. So if you go to McCall's and you look in their costume section and you look for the poodle skirt, they have a very, very simple poodle skirt that's a 360 skirt. So like if you took the sides and held it out, you could do this with it. And it would be a complete half circle on both sides. And it has a very simple waist that you just put an elastic in it. It's folded over. It takes me 3 hours to make this skirt because it has 21 feet in hem. And I'm hemming the stupid thing for 2 months. It takes me forever to hem it. And, but if you do it out of a fabric that doesn't necessarily need to be hemmed, those go together really fast. And it does take 5 yards of fabric to make one. But it's a beautiful skirt. It's nice on every shape and figure. You can put stuff over it. You can put stuff, you know, tuck it in, you can untuck it, things like that. That's the skirts I use for my dance skirts. And then underneath of them, all my girls wear either dance pants or culottes or tights or some sort of thing. So when you do the turn, those skirts tend to lift. There isn't anything immodest underneath of it. And especially if you're up on a stage. That, you know, if I'm up on a stage, you can see here. But if I go up on a stage, it goes up to there because you can see up. So that's just another thing to keep in mind. Yes. Oh, you said, okay. Modesty, check in here. You'd be surprised to see that if only it wasn't here. Make sure your skirt pants go all the way down and all the way up. No belly dancers. Unless you're in a belly dancing class. We don't want belly dancers. Ladies, bend over in front of a mirror. Self-explanatory. Oh boy. Attitude. Attitude is big. That's why I made it big. Attitude is so important. It can destroy an entire presentation if you have a crappy attitude. Even if you're the only dancer that has a crappy attitude. Because people are going to be focusing on one thing that's different. And you cannot praise Yahweh or give Him the glory if you have a crappy attitude. Which makes everything you're doing a clanging cymbal. And clanging cymbals, you want to think you're one of those, right? It's annoying. It annoys people around you. I'm sure it annoys God. I mean, it's just, it's our gift to Him, I think, is more attitude than ability. I have danced with people who were not physically beautiful. They were not necessarily in great shape. They weren't. They didn't necessarily know how to do the dance moves. But they were beautiful spirit. They had a wonderful attitude. And I enjoyed dancing with them because that's what drew me to them. There was a gentleman in the dance class, the beginning dance class yesterday, who are you glorifying? There's a place and a time to go flying by with your foot over your head. And when that time comes, go for it. But if we're in a circle of people and you're the only one who is flying by taking someone in the back of the head, that's not the right place for us. So your attitude is so important. And that also goes along with, you know, who's leading your circle. And they start doing something, you're like, oh man, that's wrong. They're doing that dance wrong. You just time on those songs. We get the songs off YouTube and we practice them and we do all this work for that. So we have a unified circle to show you what the dance looks like from all angles. Well, every once in a while, one of us will mess up a song and the other ones all know they messed up, but what do? We do the song right and we follow the leader. We follow the leader because that is community in the circle. And that is, the attitude is not, I'm going to do this right. The attitude is what is going to bring people into worship. And that goes with flag dance, it goes with regular dance. The attitude is so important. And God looks on the heart, does not look on the outer building. Neighbors, be respectful. They're there. Don't punch them. Space, I've talked about already. Watch out. Whether you're the one with the flag or somebody else has a flag, watch out. I mean, yeah, they hit you and it was their fault, but that's not going to fix your black guy. Just watch out both ways. Poles are very long. If you have a flag, you're responsible. That lady who walked right past me, if I had hit her, whose fault would have that been? It would have been mine. I had a pole, I hit her, even though she was not being respectful in my space. I still hit her. So we have to be careful of that. And then follow your leader as well. Worship dance versus presentation dance. To me, worship dance is like watercolor painting. I paint, I'm an artist. Watercolor is very flowy, things mix together, you lay down one wash, put on another wash, things move into each other, things like that. Presentation dance to me is like acrylic. Acrylic, you can make very exact things. You can just bring down a perfect square, and that square's not going anywhere, kind of thing. This is one of my paintings I did, and it's a watercolor. There's washes in there, and I did salt treatment and stuff like that. Worship dance, there is no wrong. If you're up here and you're doing a mime that everybody else is doing in the woods and you didn't mean it, and you're like, oh no, it's okay. The point of worship dance is to worship. He's looking at your heart, he's looking at your desire, and it'd be really nice if you're going the same direction and everybody else in the circle just so you don't get run over. It's okay if you never figure out how to do it. The point is that you worship you. That's the whole point. Presentation dance, be in practice for 6 months. I can demand or ask that you know the dance before we do it. Because we are doing this to show other people. Worship dance, you're doing it, is between you and Yahweh. You're dancing this for Yahweh. Presentation dance, you are dancing for Yahweh, and you're dancing for the people who are watching to show them Yahweh. Because what you do is a reflection of Him, and that's the goal. So presentation dance, that's where I might get a little picky, like, all right, you gotta hit that the woods now, kind of thing. Because in that, there is perfection, there is unity to make that happen. What we are gonna do is worship dance. So, if you go the wrong way with flying, it's totally fine. We're going to do like a big presentation and it was really huge. I might be like, you need to go that way, kind of thing. So I don't get a little picky on worship. Presentation dance, I guess I can be a little. Let's do it right. Ideas. Where do you get ideas for flags, for music, for dances? Music to me is huge. You can listen to a song and just see movement. A lot of the worship songs that I do, start dancing with people too. The internet is another great place. You can see other people's dances. You can go, learn dances and things like that. YouTube is pretty cool. So be careful what your inquiry brings up. Other people, I've learned many things from other people. I've got flag ideas from other people. Yahweh, sometimes just gives you something that's incredibly beautiful, and it's all Him. Pictures, fabric, find a really cool fabric and have to make a flag out of it just because it's too cool not to. And then emotion is another one. I'm a woman, I'm an artist, emotional. Sometimes you just feel something and you just have to move that way. That's it? All right. Everybody come on and grab a flag. You want that one? Okay, these are little ones. Go ahead and grab one of those. Listen, these are kind of heavy. Let's go. These are fun. All right, if you have a flag, please step back so anyone who doesn't have a flag can use one. Okay, so I'm going to give you, take one of those. Anybody else short? No. These are fun. This one's a good one too. It's not too heavy. These are my giant ones. They're so big that I can't even hold one of them. Let's see. These are good ones. There's two of them.
Usually it's better to hold your flag at an angle so that way you're not guillotining the people around you.
pull up, you're not going to take up as much room, and your flag will be bigger. And you hold it out. And then you can go back the other way. Kind of thing. Great. What else? I guess just play for a minute. Just play and move around with your flag and see what you can do. And you can also move your other hand. You have two hands. So if everyone wants to be like an old friend, you can do a trick of the up and down, a Mayan cross in front of you, a coupe with scoop down, come back over, a three-point turn, which is turn, and then a coupe the other way. Kind of thing. Any dance move that you can do with your hands, you can do with your flag. You have to move a little slower, because you have a lot more mass to move, but any dance move you have, how much time do I have left?
Zero.
Oh, it is now 23. Or 24. The other breakout sessions are going to start in 5 minutes if you wish to go to a different breakout session. Nothing is coming in here next. So I think we can keep going if we wanted to. If you'd like to stay and play with flags, or maybe we can make up a dance or something, that is fine. If you wanted to go to a different breakout session and do something different, that is fine as well. My official breakout is done, but we can keep playing if you want. If you're a kid, you got to convince your mom and dad to stay. Okay? Thank you very much. I was thinking that if we wanted to, I was thinking that if we wanted to do something for the talent show tomorrow, we could do something. Something really easy, really simple with flags.